Like 40% of the human population, we live within 100 miles of a coast. And here, in Great Mills, we're only about 5 miles from a coast. Our coasts, as you can see, are beautiful and bountiful, but they're also in danger. The seas are rising across the planet, threatening our homes, but also the farms where we grow our food. For instance, the eastern shore of Maryland was farmed for many years by native peoples before the British colonists arrived, and it is still heavily farmed even today. But America's first farms are starting to go underwater. Our history is quite literally drowning. And even as we lose land in our own backyards, we're losing land in Vietnam and Bangladesh, two coastal countries where we grow a large portion of the world's rice. And when we talk about climate change, we often talk about it like it's this thing of the future, something we can worry about in a couple of years or even a couple of decades. But climate change is happening. It's happening now. And here in Maryland, the symptoms of the disease are already starting to show. Many people are unaware, but there is an invisible flood moving far inland in advance of the surface floods that can drown our homes and our farms. And that invisible flood is called saltwater intrusion, and it can make our water undrinkable. And it means that many of the crops growing along our coastlines have salty and wet feet. That is, their roots are burrowing below ground, searching for pure water, but they're finding only salt. And you can see what that looks like in this picture here. All of this white stuff along the edge of this farm field is salt. And just like in Vietnam, in Bangladesh, it can feel like our Maryland farmers are fighting a losing battle. Here in the Chesapeake Bay region, sea level rise rates are 3 times the global average. And that means that our communities are some of the first to be hit by the slow burn of climate change. And unfortunately, we're not going to be able to stop climate change right now or reverse it, reverse the tides. But what we can do is work together. We can work together as researchers, as farmers, and local government agencies to design solutions that can help us prevent climate change in the future, but also allow us to thrive as communities right now. And when I say communities, I mean communities of people, but also of plants and animals. So, what do? We have to manage the transition. And that means thinking about climate change as a moving target. So what's going to work now on this farm field won't work in 5 years. And what works in 5 years isn't going to work in 10 years. With some of the fastest rates of sea level rise on the planet, the eastern seaboard of the United States is at the leading edge of climate change. And it is our job to manage that moving edge. The first thing we need are maps, like this one, that can help us understand the current extent of saltwater intrusion, but also understand where it's headed. And that will provide us with an early warning system that can help us generate a targeted plan for every stage of saltwater intrusion. And so my team is working to develop some of these first ever maps of saltwater intrusion, giving us eyes on the disease for the very first time. And so you can see here in this map, all of these pink areas are where we believe saltwater intrusion to be right now in 2 coastal Maryland counties, in Dorchester and in Somerset. And so if we can understand where saltwater intrusion is, but also understand the rate of its spread, we can help fight it. That'll help us fight it and maybe even contain it. The second thing we have to do is work together. We have to work together as landowners and as scientists and as policymakers to design solutions that can help us protect our environmental health, but also the farmer or landowner's bottom line. And third, we have to start making changes now that can help us prevent climate change in the future. And if we can do these three things, we can save our coastlines. So let me give you some examples of what that might look like. Saltwater intrusion is leading to the large-scale death of coastal timber plantations and forests, often called ghost forests. And we're going to watch a short clip just now that will give you a sense of what that looks like, the dramatic impact that saltwater intrusion is having on our systems.
When you see a ghost forest for the first time, you're struck by how eerie it is. It's sort of like a ghost town. This ground is now too salty and too wet to support living trees.
If left unchecked, saltwater intrusion can burn trees from the inside out. And the understory that's left can become overrun with invasive species. And these invasive species can choke out native marsh plants, and they do not provide good habitat for nesting bird species. However, we can help design solutions that will enable landowners to remove timber early. We can use our early warning systems, these maps, to help us identify the optimum time to remove timber so that the landowners can maximize their profits and minimize their financial losses. And at the same time, we can promote the transition of these ghost forests into marshes. And so my team has been working very closely with the Maryland Department of Planning and the Maryland Department of Natural Resources, two Maryland agencies that are thinking about this a lot. And we're asking really tough questions like, what happens to your property rights as your land slips underwater? We can't ask landowners to bear the full burden of climate change alone. These people are our neighbors, and we can help support them with science-based management strategies and policies. In some cases, the traditional crops we grow are failing. So the typical mid-Atlantic rotation of corn, soy, and wheat is no longer viable. And these crops are not adapted to high concentrations of salt, and they can't sit around for a long time with wet feet. And so my team is working to develop some new alternative crop rotations better adapted to this new normal. And so we're experimenting with sorghum, a salt-tolerant soybean, and malting barley for many of our microbreweries in this area. And we are not the only people working on this. There are Norwegian farmers who are experimenting with a salt-tolerant potato. And in Louisiana, they're experimenting with a salt-tolerant rice that could be grown in many coastal low-lying regions like Vietnam and Bangladesh. And many a health nut will be pleased to know that quinoa is actually a very salt-tolerant crop. However, there is another issue. Farm soils are loaded with nutrients like nitrogen and phosphorus from decades of fertilizer applications. And these nutrients are leading to toxic algal blooms in our water bodies that can be seen from space. And this image here shows you a map of the current impact that agriculture is already having along our coastlines, such as causing the formation of the dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico. And the problem is that saltwater intrusion only makes matters worse. Because of its unique chemistry, it can actually release even more nitrogen and phosphorus from farm soils. So you can imagine that as saltwater intrusion marches across the landscape, this could have potentially devastating consequences for water quality all along the eastern seaboard. However, there are options we can plant fast-growing grass species like a switchgrass that can suck nutrients out of the soil and store it in its plant tissues. And many livestock operations are interested in using some of these fast-growing species as bedding for chickens. So you can imagine that an endeavor like this could actually provide a farmer with income as their land transitions, help promote water quality, and prevent species invasions. These are all great ideas, but as we think about the changing face of farming along our coastlines, it will be critical to involve farmers at every step of the way. We have to ensure that there is a market that they can tap into, and that we take into account their farming heritage and wealth of knowledge. So that is, a scientist can't just come in and tell farmers what to do without understanding where they're coming from and leveraging their generations of expertise and understanding their financial constraints. For example, the equipment that's needed to grow that potato is very different than the equipment that's needed to grow soybean, such as seen here. And so my team is dedicated to working very closely with farmers in order to make sure that we are designing management solutions that work for them now and also in the future. In some cases, we have already lost large swaths of coastal timber plantations, forests, and farms to the invisible flood of saltwater intrusion. We didn't know that it was coming until it was too late. But that doesn't mean that we should give up hope. We can facilitate the transition of these areas into marshes. Marshes that are filled with native grass species, and marshes that can serve as sponges for sediment and agricultural inputs, like fertilizers. These marshes can promote environmental health, which means they can support a thriving crab industry, and they can also provide nesting habitat for many endangered species. Marshes are also very good at storing carbon, and coming up with strategies to store more carbon on our landscapes is actually a key way that we can fight climate change in the long term. And that is by sucking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and storing it in plant tissues and storing it in soils. And so my team was really interested in the carbon storage potential of farms as they transition into marshes. And it turns out the potential is huge. So I'm going to show you some data because I'm a scientist and I can't help myself. So on the y-axis, we have soil carbon concentration, and the x-axis is a transect across a salt-damaged field. So imagine you're standing in the center of a cornfield, and you're looking out towards the marsh. These are the levels of carbon in your soil. So in the tidal marsh, we have very high concentrations of carbon. That's to be expected. What is incredible is how much carbon is on the edge of those fields, in the field edge and the ditch bank, where you're starting to see some of that saltwater intrusion. In fact, the carbon levels are 5 times higher than they are in that crop area where the corn plants are struggling to survive. So, on these fields, where it's becoming increasingly challenging to turn a profit, we could actually allow the migration of marshes into these farm fields. Maybe we even help them out a little bit by planting some native grass species. If we did that, we could store a lot of carbon, and we could store it very quickly. So, in some cases, consider a situation where we are subsidizing the farming of carbon rather than the farming of corn. This work is, in a way, a struggle to stay ahead of a moving target. And to do that requires coordination and collaboration among researchers from many different disciplines. And so we're working together to develop these first ever maps of saltwater intrusion to understand where it is and also where it's headed. And every day my team is working to gain a deeper understanding of what crops are likely to grow, how we can store more carbon, and how we can protect water quality as our coastlines transition. The truth is, we aren't going to halt climate change in its tracks. We can't slow the rising seas, at least not in the short term. To do that will require coordinated global action. But that doesn't mean that we can't do anything about it. When the world is sick, we wear masks. We adapt to this new normal. And we can help our neighbors, our communities, and our planet if we manage the transition to the new normal using science-based solutions. Climate change is impacting nearly every single agricultural system on the planet. Everyone, at some point, will have to adapt. So why not be on the cutting edge of climate change adaptation? We are already building these maps of saltwater intrusion to understand where it is and where it's headed. And we are already working together as researchers, as farmers, and as policymakers to design these science-based solutions. And we have the opportunity to make changes now that can help prevent climate change in the long term. We could farm carbon and not corn. And what's remarkable to me is that the state of Maryland could actually be a global leader in climate change adaptation, especially when it comes to sea level rise and saltwater intrusion. We are already building the tools we need, and we are already working together towards this goal. So I say, let's do it.